Thanks, Ronnie. Good morning, everyone. Great to see you this morning. My name's James. If you're visiting us for the first time, I hope you enjoy your time with us. Because what we do here, Sunday by Sunday, is critical. We really do think about the biggest issues of life and death. More significant than the stock prices, more significant than cryptocurrency, more significant than who won the sport yesterday. What we're doing is, it really does matter. And so why don't I pray now as we get into this passage we've just had read to us. Father, we do thank you that we can gather like this. And we're conscious still that many around us in this country and around the world are unable to gather in public. We thank you that we can. We do pray this time will be profitable to us as we continue to work out what it is to be your people. So we pray this in Jesus' name. I don't think there's a more important question than the question, how can I be accepted by God? What does it mean to be accepted by God? I don't think there's a more important question, actually. Now, of course, to most Australians, the answer is obvious. Of course I'll be accepted by God. I'm pretty good. I haven't murdered anyone. I've tried to live a good life. I'm a pretty responsible person. Every now and then I go to church. Surely that's enough to be accepted by God. And yet when you come to this passage at the end of John chapter 2, it's so arresting. It's so revolutionary. It's so shocking. Have a look down here again at chapter 2, verse 24. Because when people come to Jesus, Jesus rejects their advances. He would not entrust himself to them. Straight away, we have this massive problem. Why is Jesus not accepting these people as they come to him? It's like he's setting off this massive bomb. All our assumptions about we can just come to God and he'll accept us. Of course, God will accept me. Just seems to blow up in our face, that kind of thinking. I can't assume that if I'm good enough, or spiritual enough, or religious enough, I'll just kind of make it into heaven. Why not? At the end of verse 24, John says, because Jesus knew all people. Jesus refused to accept people because he knew what we were like. Now this may well be the most depressing sermon introduction you ever heard in your life. I get that. I'm depressed too. That is, surely Jesus loves everyone. Surely Jesus accepts everyone. Surely Jesus is an all-loving God, full of grace and mercy. What's going on here? Well, why not accept these people? Is it an off day? What does it take to be accepted by God? See, what we've got here straight away is bad news. Outrageously bad news, actually. And remember the context that we've been looking at? We're up in Jerusalem, and all the crowds have gathered there. You can see the Passover feast, verse 23. And Jesus is among them, doing all these signs, pointing to the life that he's come to bring. And unsurprisingly, people come to him and want to attach themselves to him. But he doesn't entrust himself to them because he knew all people. He knew what we were like. He knows that in the end, anyone will attach themselves to someone who does good enough party tricks, who's impressive enough. But more than that, verse 25, he knew what was in man. Which just raises the obvious question, what's wrong with us? What's the problem? And while that question is kind of hanging in the air, see what he does in the beginning of chapter 3. He tells us the problem, actually. There's a clear link between the end of chapter 2 and the beginning of chapter 3. You see, at the end of chapter 2, No one, he didn't know to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man, now there was up man. So what John's doing now is giving us a case study. Now, exhibit A, Nicodemus. Now we're going to know what the problem with being human is. Now, if you're depressed about the introduction so far, you are now going to be confused as well, okay? Because when you look at Nicodemus, it doesn't make sense. I mean, why would John use Nicodemus as an exhibit of what is wrong with humanity? You couldn't select a better person if you tried. If you think of the most bestest person in your community, excuse me there, grammar, this guy's not a cheat, he's not a second-hand car salesman, he's not a crooked politician. He's the best of the best with honors. He's got the best credentials, the best connections. He's at the top of everyone's list. He's part of the religious elite, he's part of the cultural elite. In fact, he's at the very top of the religious tree. He's super smart. He's a teacher of Israel. He's like a professor of Jerusalem University. He's the toppest of the top dogs in the religious world. So when it comes to being accepted by God, this guy's got it. And he's got the right answer. Look there, verse 2. You're a teacher come from God. No one can do these signs unless God is with him. Surely that's enough, Jesus. Surely that's enough for a kind of platinum life membership to the Team Jesus Club. What does Jesus say? Verse 3. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. To the most religious guy on the planet, to one of the sharpest intellects in Jerusalem, to one of the most upstanding members of society, Jesus says, it's not enough. Unless you're born again. And that's where it gets even tricky for us. Because when we hear that phrase, born again Christian, we kind of get very nervous. We kind of think of, you know, pulpit pumping televangelists from a particular country, rhyming with Anthetia. You might think that a born-again Christian is like the serious version of a Christian. It's like common garden Christians, and then there's born-again Christians. They're the real deal. They're kind of genius level. No, Jesus doesn't say that at all. And unless you are born again, you can't be accepted by God. Everyone needs to be born again if they're to be right with God. Which raises a much more obvious problem for Nicodemus. How is this possible? And for us, if Nicodemus isn't good enough, what chance is there for the rest of us? If the guy who is culturally elite, religiously professional, intellectually brilliant, if he can't be accepted by God, how do we get him? See, this point is, unless you want him, you've got nothing. Now, I use this illustration very nervously, because I've never baked a cake in my life. But my understanding is, if you try and make a cake, and instead of putting sugar in, you put cups of salt in, it's not going to go so well. Is that right? Yeah, okay, let's go again. Now you can put on, with your salty cake, you can put on as much icing sugar as you like, as much icing as you like, it's still going to taste rubbish. The only way forward is to start again, to make a whole new cake. You with me, is that? Show my friend. Yeah, good, back with you. I was nervous. That's the point that Jesus is making with this. You've got to start again.
You can't just kind of add religious stuff or intellectual stuff or cultural stuff or whatever else it is and hope to be accepted by God.
You go to church twice each Sunday. You can pray five times a day. You can go to every other religion in the world. And it won't be enough. It doesn't get you any closer to God. Or you can turn internally. You can go for spiritual experiences and amass them higher and higher. But find no peace with God.
So that's the bad news. Because I'm feeling particularly jolly today, I'm now going to give you the worst news. Okay? This is fun, isn't it? We have fun. So the bad news is, Nicodemus needs to be born again. Okay? What's the worst news? Let's have a look down at verses 4 to 8. Here it is. There's nothing he can do to be accepted. Because, you see, then Nicodemus asks the obvious question, verse 4, how can I be born again? He's not an idiot. He knows it's physically impossible. He can see every mother in history kind of shaking their head. What is Jesus saying when he says, you need to be born again? Well, he explains in verse 5. Look at verse 5. Unless one is born of water and the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. To be born again means to be born of water and the Spirit. Okay, good, clear, done. It's confusing, isn't it? It's an unfamiliar image choice, this born of water and the Spirit. It's not unfamiliar to me, it is, though. It's not unfamiliar to the professor of Old Testament. He knows, or at least he should know, exactly what it means to be born of water and the Spirit. Because he's taught on the book of Ezekiel for 20 years. We don't know because we haven't taught Old Testament. And so we need a reminder. Ezekiel 36 is a great promise from God. We have looked on the screen. Here God makes this incredible promise to his people. He says, I will sprinkle clean water on you. And I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit in you. These two things come together. Washing with water, spiritually cleansed. A new heart, a new spirit in you. The old heart, the sinful heart, ripped out, a new heart put in. That's what it means to be born again. That was God's great promise. Just so it is, it's not about water baptism. This is not about a special blessing from the Holy Spirit after you become a Christian. What is it? This is a work that only God can do. Nicodemus, you can't do this. Only God can make you born again. Only God can make you born by water and the Spirit. Why is this so troubling for you? Why is this worse than you do? Well, because he can't do anything to be accepted by God. It's troubling for us for exactly the same reason. Turning up to church, paying our taxes, patiently listening to great Aunt Mildred prattle on a Sunday afternoon patiently. None of that counts. Because what is true of physical birth is true of spiritual birth. Let me explain. You did nothing, I did nothing, to be born into this world. I contributed nothing, I exerted no effort and no energy. Just popped it up. A bit more to it than that, but you know, that's generally the idea. While I can do nothing to be physically born in this world, I can do nothing spiritually to be born in this world. I'm entirely dependent on the work of another, on the effort of another, on the labor of another. Just down the road is the Royal Sydney Golf Club. You may have heard it before. You can turn up there this afternoon with boxes of gold bullion.
and apply for membership and not be allowed.
You can turn up there this afternoon with a blank check and you will not be allowed membership. Because you need a sponsor. You need someone on the inside to get you in. That's the only way. Nicodemus needs to learn exactly the same lesson. The only way in is through someone else. Someone else's work.
Now again, I'm conscious that this is not the most uplifting passage at this point. You might already be rethinking the whole Christian thing. Maybe Jesus isn't as warm and loving as I first thought. If Jesus doesn't accept everyone, maybe I need to rethink where I stand. But it's interesting, isn't it? For those of us who come to Jesus with our credentials, for those of us who come to Jesus in strength, with honours, it is bad news. Jesus is utterly formidable. He stands against us with all our pretense of what we can do and what we contribute and why we should be admitted. Because people with power will never be accepted by Jesus on the basis of that power. It's not always like this though, is it? I mean, in a couple of weeks we'll get to John chapter 4 and the woman at the well, the woman who comes to Jesus and has a very different conversation. A very different interaction, a woman who comes to Jesus broken, with nothing. But who's met with grace and kindness. So how can I be born again? How can I be accepted by God? Please tell me the good news. We're getting there now. Verses 9 to 15. But first, another little puzzle. Have a look down at verse 13. No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from him, the Son of Man. What will unlock our acceptance with God? John says it's only the one who ascends into heaven, descending from him. The word always gets confusing, and you need to come back to heaven on this. But our acceptance only comes from someone who has been and come from heaven. And inside us, we're saying already. As good as Nicodemus was, he could never spiritually regenerate himself. And so John explains that further in verse 14. Have a look there, another kind of wild Old Testament image. Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up. You remember that Old Testament reading we heard before from Charlie? This strange time when God's people were judged for their complaining again. It's a familiar thing. And God sends this plague of snakes, these serpents, on them. But after Moses prays, they are given a sign. As the serpent is held up, as the serpent is lifted up, if you look at that serpent, you will live. John says that is just the promise that is fulfilled here in Jesus. If you look up, if you look to the Son who is lifted up on the cross, that is where you find life. That is where you can be accepted by God. The great fulfillment of Numbers 21. Through the shameful death on the cross, we can be rescued. Verse 15, whoever believes in him may have eternal life. Not that Jesus is a party trick land. Anyone will follow him. But that Jesus, who is lifted up on the cross, not everyone's going to believe in him. Nothing exciting about that. Except for the fact that that is the path to eternal life.
say, if you think that your acceptance with God depends on what you do or what you've done, please hear me rightly. You will never be accepted by God. But if you look at the death of Jesus, not as a terrible accident, but as your only hope of salvation, that's the key. And can I say, being born again, looking to Jesus, does change everything. It's not like we just kind of get our ticket into heaven and kind of go on with our lives as normal. It changes everything. This rebirth, this new birth, this being born of water and the Spirit, it changes everything. Remember the promise of Ezekiel? We get a new spirit, we get a new heart. Some of us are sad, we don't get a new personality, but we are changed. How? Someone said to me once, if you're an extrovert, I don't know why they said that, if you're an extrovert, becoming a Christian doesn't make you an introvert. But it does make it more pleasant for those of you, those around you, to live with you. And it makes a difference to you as well. Even as you come to church. We don't come to church as a kind of religious obligation, hoping that somehow we'll build up enough points to get us into heaven. We don't serve morning tea to prove to everyone how good I am. We don't talk to people after church so that they will think that I'm a nice person and listen well. We come to church because this is the family that God's blessed us with. There's a great joy together each week. We serve morning tea, we serve on the music team, we serve in a whole range of ways because God has given us new hearts that turn us outside ourselves to others. We make coffee for people now, apparently. Not because we're addicts, but because we want to be a welcoming church. We want to welcome people in. That's the great blessing of being born. Of having new hearts and new spirit. In a few minutes, I'll take some questions if things are not clear, but for the moment, let's pray that God would help us rejoice in the work that He's done. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank You so much that as we see the Lord Jesus lifted up, we can look to Him and be rescued. We can look to Him and be saved. We praise You for the work of Your Spirit in turning us, in regenerating our hearts, in giving us this life. In Jesus' name we praise You. Amen.
We're going to stand and sing.